Good evening and Namaskar. I'm very happy to welcome you to this lecture on space. Space is of great interest to young people, particularly because of the spectacular success that ISRO has been having for so many years now, and particularly over the last few years. So I thought it would be very interesting to have the chairman of ISRO, Dr. S Kiran Kumar, to come here to talk to us. Now, he has multiple portfolios. He's the chairman of ISRO, he's the chairman of the Space Commission, and he's secretary to the Department of Space. And he took up the responsibility in January. And before he did that, he was at the Space Application Center in Ahmedabad for many years. And he was the director, before that he was the deputy director. He has had many important positions in ISRO all through. So he's one of the rare persons who is educated in the same town all through. Okay, so he got his bachelor's from National College in Bangalore. Then he was at Bangalore University, and then he got an M.Tech at the Indian School of Science in 1975. So that was the time when I started going to the Indian School of Science from the country student at DIFR. So I'm sure that our paths would have crossed in a mess, and maybe we even got together into a fight or whatever. But then my association with him started about 10 years ago when I started getting slowly involved in various science programs of ISRO, and I got to know him very well in recent times, particularly because of the Space Commission meetings. He has got great regard for science, which means that we go to him always whenever we have some scientific program in mind, to set up a center, to set up something, when is ASTROSAT going. We have been going to him for many years for such help. And now, of course, he is at the apex of the pyramid, and he was more helpful than he has always been. He has been involved in many important programs of ISRO all through his career, which has spanned many years. He has been involved with applications, okay, so satellites, what satellites do, the communication, meteorology. Okay, they are involved in the development of launch vehicles also. And the basis has always been to provide easy and reliable access to space. Okay, then he makes imaging sensors, detectors for satellites, and he had the sensors also on the Mars orbiter. He has made very important contributions to Chandrayaan-1 and to the Mars orbiter, apart from sensors themselves. He is involved in a host of programs. He is a distinguished person. He is a fellow of many learned academies. He has got all kinds of awards, and he has got the Padma Shri in 2014. If you see walking on the street, you wouldn't know that he is such a special person, because he has a very humble and simple demeanor, as you will see in a moment. But he is very wise with all matters of space, and we can all look forward to a very interesting lecture by him. And after the lecture, as usual, we have a few questions. I know that there will be many, many questions, but he arrived just 10 minutes ago, and he had to leave early in the morning, and before that we have to have many discussions with him. So the questions, there will be this short period available for the questions. Thank you.
Good evening to all of you. Thank you, Ajit, for the generous introduction. And at the outset, let me thank Ajit Kembhavi for inviting me for this presentation on the various activities we do in ISRO in relation to the space, space science and space exploration activities. The space science activities in India, we can say, started way back in 1963 with the launch of the first sounding rocket, which was an US-made Naked Apache from Tumba on the 21st of November 1963. Later you will see it was exactly 50 years later that we had our Mars mission on the 5th of November 2013, which went up. With this, the Indian space science and space program began, and it was dedicated to the United Nations on the 2nd of February 1968. ISRO started launching a series of our own sounding rockets. RH-75 was the first truly Indian sounding rocket, which was followed by RH-100 and 125. Then later we had two-stage rockets imported from Russia and France, total of about 1139 sounding rockets were launched between 70 and 91. Currently, we have operational sounding rockets, which include three versions, RH-200, 300 Mark II, and 560. And you can also see the kind of payloads they can put and altitudes they can go up to, starting from 75 kilometers up to 550 kilometers. Primarily, they have been carrying payloads which can provide information on meteorology, middle atmospheric studies, and upper atmospheric studies. And we have both at Tumba as well as the spaceport Sriharikota, where these sounding rockets are launched. Presently, RH-200 is being regularly launched during the third Wednesday of every month. And just on this 15th of July, we had 100th consecutively successful rocket going up from TERLS. Many important campaigns have been done using RH series of rockets. The first was monsoon experiment, under which over 1,000 rockets were launched. Then equatorial wave studies by Space Physics Laboratory, about 51 launches of RH-200. This was done from SHAR. Then the dynamic middle atmosphere experiments conducted by SPL. We did about 180 launches of this rocket from TERLS. Then we also did, during 2010, about 11 launches to study and understand the effect of solar eclipse on Earth's atmosphere. Then the sounding rocket experiment itself, launch of about 11 sounding rockets, 3 RH-560, 4 RH-300, and 4 RH-200, are planned during 2015 and 16 to address the scientific issues in atmosphere, upper atmosphere, ionosphere, thermosphere, physics. This is primarily being done by Space Physics Laboratory and the National Atmospheric and Research Laboratories, which are also part of Department of Space. They are going to carry a series of instruments, Langmuir probe, electron density, neutral wind, photometer, etc. That is a series of sounding rockets, and of course this sounding rockets activity is going to continue, and also there is a significant interest even among other countries. Some of the South American countries are interested in working with us in establishing facilities at their place, and this activity is going to continue, and it provides an opportunity for conducting experiments using a set of payloads. Then our space-borne systems, the very first one was with Aryabhata, which was launched in 1975. Again, this year in April, we celebrated 40 years of completion of this first launch, and it carried X-ray astronomy, aeronomy, and the solar physics experiments on this particular satellite. We had, of course, Anuradha, which was an Indian cosmic ray experiment, which went up on the Space Shuttle Space Lab 3, where PRL, Physical Research Laboratory, ISRO, and TIFR worked together. And this provided the first unambiguous direct measurements of ionization states of individual nitrogen, oxygen, neon ions of anomalous cosmic rays. We also had a set of piggyback experiments in the X-ray astronomy and atmospheric sciences in the Stretch Rohini series of satellites, what is called SROS-C2, in 1994, which carried gamma ray burst experiment developed by ISRO. It detected gamma ray bursts and provided time information, intensity variations with time. Then we also had a retarding potential analyzer, which was developed by National Physical Laboratories. It measured ionospheric parameters to study latitudinal variations of ionization structure. Then we had the Indian X-ray astronomy experiment, carried out observational studies of many bright X-rays. This was on our IRSP-3. By this time, we had our own launcher, PSLV, carrying these satellites. Then this had three identical pointed mode proportional counters. This was developed by ISRO along with TIFR. Then we also had a geostationary satellite carrying the solar X-ray spectrometer, which was launched in 2003. and it contained high spectral and temporal resolution X-ray spectrometers. And it had two types of detector modules, low energy detector where PRL and ISAC worked together, and then high energy detector system where TIFR was involved. With these activities in the various science missions, the Chandrayaan-1 was planned, and this is an Indian mission with very significant international participation, and it was indeed it set an example how space missions could be carried out with the collaboration of a large number of countries. We had about 5 payloads from India and 6 payloads from abroad. You can see here TMC, terrain mapping camera, hyperspectral imager, lunar laser ranging instrument, then high energy X-ray spectrometer, moon impact probe were all built by India. Whereas the Chandrayaan X-ray spectrometer, ESA and ISRO worked together for that. Then we had the near infrared spectrometer by ESA, then sub-KEV reflecting analyzer, ESA and ISRO, radome instrument, mini-SAR and M-cube, which were NASA instruments. So this was the launch itself happened in 22nd October 2008, and the public access to this long time archival data for these payloads is available through Indian Space Science Data Center website since 2013. In fact, this data is being extensively used by a large number of researchers, and we also see many of the publications coming out of data from this particular mission. And Chandrayaan-1 also made a major discovery. It was this mission which is credited with discovery of water molecules on the lunar surface, lunar exosphere. Though a large number of missions had been done to moon, it is Chandrayaan-1 which demonstrated that water and water molecules are present on the surface of moon. Water molecules in the lunar exosphere and subsurface water ice deposits in the base of the craters of permanent sun shadow regions. Presence of large expanses of crystalline feldspar on the lunar surface. Reflection of solar wind protons. Then three-dimensional conceptualization of many craters of interest. Water molecules itself, the solar wind interaction. In fact, it also changed the perception of many processes that were taking place on the moon. Based on the earlier data, it was felt that moon is bone dry, but then based on the information that was gathered during this mission, the total scenario change. The hydroxyl and the OH molecules, their expected signature of absorption in the infrared. Of course, the primary instrument for this M-cube was designed by NASA JPL, and the mini-SAR, which was again a synthetic aperture radar of a very small size, and using these two, significant amount of information extraction happened. This particular image you would have probably seen many times. This shows the blue in this shows the 3 micron absorption associated with the presence of OH and H2O. Red regions show the 2 micron region iron bearing minerals information, and also the reflected brightness in the 2.4 micron region. We also carried a moon impact probe, which did show on the 14th of November when the moon impact probe landed on the surface of moon. On its journey, it did pick up the water molecules, and of course initially, because it was not certain at that point of time whether you could believe the data, the first discovery went to M-cubed and Mini-SAR and not to this chase instrument which was there on the MIP. But of course subsequently it corroborated the information that was picked up. And synthetic aperture radar again was used, and this ensured, this is an S-band synthetic aperture radar which mapped the polar terrain, and using this they could establish that presence of water ice in the craters. And this shows, of course, because of the premature completion of the mission, there are certain gaps in the total data sets. But otherwise, whatever data was picked up was good enough to demonstrate many of the aspects. MINISAR data here shows the ice is heterogeneously distributed. And this is the lunar laser ranging instrument, which was built by LIOS. And this shows, again, the surface, the heights at the different places. And the dark blue region here shows the South Pole Aitken region. Then we had the endogenic water. The study of M3 spectra revealed enhanced signature of OH and water in the Compton-Belkovich volcanic complex. And it also found evidence of hydrated magma, indicating episodic and explosive magmatic events. Now, these results have changed the earlier concept that prevailed before Chandrayaan-1. When Moon, based on the study of Apollo rocks, was considered to be bone dry and dormant. This again, the image what you are seeing is from the terrain mapping camera and the LRO data. And using this, evidences of volcanic vent and lava pond were found. Then we also had the hyperspectral imager, which shows the giant impact hypothesis and the hot formation of Moon. Magma ocean concepts were all got significant impetus using this data. Then another important development was on the results of SARA, a new dimension of solar wind surface interaction. It was believed earlier that all the solar wind is not getting reflected from the Moon surface. But these observations change those concepts. Similarly, the calcium and iron and also the aluminium and potassium, these signatures were found in the KIX data. Then this is another interesting development where, for example, you can see a buried rille region, which is actually uncollapsed portion of a lava tube, which is possible, it's possible that you could have human shelter in this particular region. And recently LRO also confirmed that this region is an uncollapsed portion of a lava tube. Then we have a large number of topographic three-dimensional anaglyph images generated on that. These are just some of the images obtained from Chandrayaan. Now, the new perception about the Moon was before Chandrayaan-1 and after Chandrayaan-1, if you see, initially it was said Moon is dry, then it became an active hydrosphere, presence of OH and water molecules in the lunar surface, lunar environment. It was considered to be geologically dead billions of years back, but there is significant amount of data which shows it is dynamic and volcanically active. You also have a complete absorption of the impinging solar wind protons by the lunar regolith. Now it is believed that about 20% of the solar wind protons are reflected from the lunar surface. Then there was no evidence of magma ocean earlier. Now it is validated that global magma ocean hypothesis is valid. Lunar surface is vulnerable to impacts of meteorites or other bodies as well as energetic particles. Now detection of potential site buried lava tubes for future human habitability on the Moon. Then of course after this successful Chandrayaan mission, of course the mission itself got truncated a little bit prematurely because of the technical problems in some of the power systems and the DC-DC converters we had on this mission. Then based on this experience and also the subsequent analysis, we embarked on the Mars Orbiter mission. Like I said, after 50 years of the first sounding rocket from TULS, on the 5th of November, we had the launch of this Mars mission. It was originally designed for orbiting around Mars with a life of about 6 months. And in this, there was going to be many firsts, because this was for the first time that we were going to get out of the Earth's sphere of influence, get into heliospheric orbit, and then get onto Mars and get captured on the Mars for orbiting around the Mars. And because there was going to be very long periods where there is no communication possible between the satellite and the ground station, it was necessary that you build in a large amount of autonomy features on the satellite, and these features should enable the satellite to take care of itself without any communication from ground. And then it also had the scientific objective of exploring the Mars surface morphology and then Martian atmosphere by indigenous scientific instruments. This, as I said, was launched on the 5th of November. Then the Trans-Mars injection happened on the 30th of November. Then the MOM spacecraft left the sphere of influence of Earth on the 4th of December 2013. Then a series of trajectory correction maneuvers, and then it got inserted into the Mars orbit on the September 24th of 2014. And this also resulted in a significant amount of enthusiasm being generated across the country among the scientific community and also the students. What picture you are seeing here is on the time, at the time of insertion, many of the schools were celebrating this particular event. That's what you are seeing on this picture. Now the trajectory itself that was chosen was very unique, and we had to do this primarily because the launcher what we had, the PSLV, could carry only about 1400 kilograms. And within this mass, we had to build in sufficient velocity injection capability into the satellite. And we went through a series of elliptical orbits. And then we also had to make sure that the propulsion systems that are used are called for operation again after a long gap of about 9 months, which is unlike what happens in most of our other satellites. The propulsion system itself was the same as what we use for our geostationary satellite, communication satellite. But in those cases, what happens is the elliptical orbit of about 200 kilometer to 24,000 kilometer is converted into 36,000 kilometer circular using the propulsion system. And propulsion system, once the job is completed, in about a month's time, it is shut down. Whereas in this case, it was required for us to operate it after a gap of about 9 months. So that was one of the challenges. Then of course the other challenges were, we were going to go almost about 400 million kilometers away from Earth. So you need to have a deep space communication capability. Then the other aspect is, the time it takes for a signal what you send can go up to 20 minutes to reach the satellite from ground. So that means by the time you know what happens, whatever command you have sent, it takes about 40 minutes back and forth. So you need to build in a large amount of autonomy onto the satellite. And all these visualization of the kind of autonomy that is needed has been demonstrated, because recently we went through the solar conjunction phase where Sun, Earth and Mars came in the same line. And for almost about 1 month, we had practically no communication with the satellite. We have gone through this phase. And now subsequently, we are operating all the payloads and the systems are working fine. And because of the significant amount of fuel that is still left, the mission is likely to last for a very long time. Now there are 5 payloads which were there on this particular satellite. We had the Lyman alpha photometer, then the methane sensor, then you have the Mars exospheric composition analyzer, then the Mars color camera, and also a thermal infrared spectrometer. And we had a series of challenges, whether it is from the structure, mechanism, propulsion, thermal, then power, communication. And communication, apart from the distance involved, we also had to make sure that the field of view of the antenna that is there on the satellite was only 2 degrees. And so this requires the satellite attitude to be very carefully controlled so that the ground antennas receive the signal care without interference. Then the trajectory analysis and also determining the orbit itself was one of the key issues. Then during the course of its journey, it also took a large number of images. Then this is one of the highest volcanoes which were seen on the solar system, Olympus Mons. Then you can also see some of the images taken from this. This is the cloud formation is near the Elysium, which is the second largest volcanic province. Then these are images of different regions on different dates and different resolutions. In fact, we had to resort to a highly elliptical orbit in this because of the limited fuel available. And this highly elliptical orbit itself gave us some very significant advantages, which we will see subsequently. These are some of the images taken from this Mars color camera and draped over the digital elevation model. And you can also see the wind streaks on the images. And the color camera itself, you can decode the individual wavelengths and then extract information. This also shows that some of the clouds, carbon dioxide present on the... And this is another very interesting observation, which is again recently corroborated with MAVEN data, and it is going to... Earlier it was felt that all the dust that is present on the surface of the Mars will not lift up to a very large height, whereas here we are seeing just beyond the limb up to 200 kilometers, up to almost 300 kilometers, there is a segment which is seen, and this is a very interesting data, and a lot of studies are going to be done on the basis of these observations. And this is another interesting thing, Phobos and Deimos, these were the moons, and we have the capability to take the images with 10-second gap, and then based on that you can see one of the moons traversing on the Mars surface. And this is the one which is very interesting, because we are the only people so far who have seen the far side of this Deimos, because all the other orbiting satellites on Mars do not have an opportunity to see the far side of this particular moon of Mars. And we are now planning to target a series of observations which can extract some more details of the far side of the moon. And then we also have the methane sensor. Large amount of data has been collected, and of course still significant amount of work needs to be done to extract the specific methane surfaces. This is one of the methane sensor outputs in 1.65 micron. And again, this is, we are the only people who are actually making observation in 1.65 micron on the surface of moon. This is a reflectance map using the reference channel, and similarly using the methane channel and the differences. So we still need to do a lot of work before we can actually extract the methane content itself and its distribution, but there are interesting results which are coming up. Then MENCA also has found carbon dioxide altitudinal variations, and then we are able to make observations with time gap, and this is also going to give a significant amount of interesting results. Then you have the LAP, one of the data of the LAP, which shows as a function of limb height what is the kind of observation that is seen. Then you also have the thermal imaging spectrometer, which is giving this data. Now, like I said, the spacecraft autonomy, the maximum Earth to Mars round trip is about 42 minutes. Then we have the onboard autonomy is implemented through autonomous fault detection, isolation, reconfiguration. Then you have to make sure that there is a continuous watching, fault detection, isolation. Then also safeguarding the spacecraft during the Mars orbit injection. And then we, since there is also a power issue, TWTA is duty cycled. And like I said, between 10th June and 2nd July, we went through the longest period of no communication between the satellite and the ground. And once we have crossed this hurdle, now we can say that in the immediate vicinity, there are no issues. All the subsystems on this satellite are functioning very well, and we expect it to last for quite a significant amount of time. And recently, we have also announced the announcement of opportunity for using the data of all the Mars instruments, and this announcement of opportunity has been put up in our website. Anybody who is interested in using this data, making analysis, can put up proposals and then go ahead and carry out their R&D and then research activities on that. Just now we are getting into the AstroSat mission. Right now, just on the 16th of August, the satellite left Bangalore. It has reached Sriharikota. Now the launch vehicle is getting assembled and we expect to launch this satellite, AstroSat, on the 28th of next month, that is in September. And this one has a scientific objectives of to understand high energy processes in binary systems containing neutron stars, black hole sources, estimate magnetic fields of neutron stars. And this will provide simultaneous multi-wavelength observations using single satellite. In fact, this data is also being looked up to by the international community. It has got UV, optical, low and high energy X-rays, and then multi-wavelength observations. Then it has also got major astronomy institutions and some of the universities in India will be participating in this. And it has got a UV telescope, then the soft X-rays, then large area X-ray proportional counter, and also CZTI instrument. And this is the going to measure the photosphere of sun, then chromosphere, then you also have different types of celestial objects. Then you have the launch itself we are planning in September, and its orbit is going to be 650 kilometer near equatorial, and it will be a low inclination orbit, about 6 degree inclination, and mission life is expected to be about 5 years. And you can see the satellite getting integrated and going through the various test phases. And this is the ultraviolet telescope, UV telescope, which is based on a Rishikritin two mirror system. It makes use of intensified CMOS detectors. And it operates in the 130 to 180 nanometer and 200 to 300 nanometer and also 320 to 550 nanometer wavelength regions. And here the lead is IUCAA, then IAA, and also collaboration with Canadian Space Agency. This is a picture of a large area xenon proportional proportional counter. And it works in the 3 to 80 keV range. And one of the things is it has got 5 times more effective area. You will see in a subsequent comparison, this happens to be one of the largest effective area instrument that is going to go up. The better than that will be going up only in the year 2021. This makes use of gas-filled proportional counters. And this is a very significant development which has happened at TIFR and Raman Research Institute. It has got about 8,000 square centimeter of the aperture area, and energy range is 3 to 80 kV. Then soft X-ray telescope, this is again TIFR in collaboration with University of Leicester, UK. And it works in the 0.3 to 8 kV region. Then the cadmium zinc telluride imager. In fact, in this particular satellite, the total weight of all the payloads together is more than about 500 and odd kilograms, which is a very significant difference compared to many of our other satellites. Then you also have a scanning sky monitor, which will scan the sky and then detect transient events. And based on these transient events, planning of the mission can be done for observations in the other wavelength and telescope usage. This is the one which I was mentioning. If you compare the worldwide X-ray missions, you can see that the LAX PC, when it goes up, will be the largest efficient effective area instrument. And then better than that, you are going to get only in the year 2024. Then all this shows where the instruments are located on the satellite. And this is another interesting thing, that AstroSat is going to be operated like an observatory in space. Data is open to both Indian and international proposers. depending on the percentage of time allocation. There is going to be a performance verification phase, which will be first 6 months after launch, and then you will have a guaranteed time, 6 months period after the performance verification phase. Then you have a regular observation phase, and then the targets of opportunity aimed at new transient sources, which cannot be predicted in advance, of course. Then 2% of the observing time is reserved for collaboration and for monitoring, maintaining the health of the instruments. Of course, challenges in realizing is, of course, it took quite a bit of time before the satellite itself and the total system was realized. But then it's a complex science mission with participation of a large number of research institutes. And this is the first mission to be operated in India as a space observatory. And it has got a 1.8 arc second resolution in the UV channel. Then it's an indigenous, this again, one of the very important developments, that indigenous thin foil gold coated aluminum X-ray optics for the SXT. High pressure counters. That was on Chandrayaan, that was on ASTROSAT. We are currently also working on Chandrayaan 2 mission, which is going to carry it, our own indigenous orbiter, lander and rover. When we started this program, of course, we had the envisage that the lander was going to be provided by the Russians. But then because of the difficulties they faced during one of their launches, the time was going to be significantly delayed. So now we have reconfigured with our own lander and rover. Now we are targeting for 2017 and 2018 time frame, a 3250 kg liftoff mass of this satellite, which will carry orbiter, lander, and the rover. And it will carry a series of instruments which will enhance what we have done in the Chandrayaan-1. Terrain mapping camera will continue, and then the IR spectrometer, which was working only up to 3 microns in the previous mission, will now work up to 5 microns, and it will be able to do a better detection of water molecules and also the mapping of this on the surface. Then we have our own synthetic aperture radar, which will be dual frequency, S and X bands, then the neutral mass spectrometer. The lander will have a seismometer and a thermal probe. And then rover also will be there, which will be moving on the surface of Moon. Of course, the one of the important aspects here is the lander realization is a new technology. We need throttleable engines for ensuring that soft landing happens on the surface of the Moon. And then protecting the lander and rover payloads from dust is one of the issues. And then in situ analysis of the lunar surface. Then we have also got an Aditya L1 mission, and this is the proposed Indian Solar Observatory around the Lagrange point L1. And here the prime objective is to design, realize and launch a satellite for solar studies to be placed in a halo orbit around the Lagrangian point 1, and it will be around 1.5 million kilometers from Earth, approximately at 1/100th of an AU. The scientific objective itself will be to study the solar dynamics in the chromosphere and the corona. And it has a suite of instruments including coronagraph and a UV imager. And the target is around 2018-2019. And orbit insertion is going to take about 100 days and about 5 years is the mission life. Now some of the science issues that could be addressed using this mission is the chromosphere transition region, then the sequence of processes occurring on different layers, origin of dynamics of the solar wind, then the solar spectral irradiance, and also the coronal magnetic field from space. And this is going to be the outside the Earth's atmosphere and its magnetosphere. It's ideal for studying the solar wind and the CMEs. And it enables no occultation of the spacecraft's line of sight. So continuous observation of sun is possible. And it's possible to do long integrations for measuring coronal magnetic fields. Then it's also will be possible to observe sun during all phases of the solar cycle. Then placing a solar spacecraft will enhance the significant capability of our missions. There are a number of payloads which are planned here. Visible emission line coronagraph, solar UV telescope, solar particle experiment, plasma analyzer package, then the solar low X-ray spectrometer, hard X-ray spectrometer, and also a magnetometer. And this magnetometer is a late addition, and a significant amount of technical challenge is there in ensuring that this magnetometer will be able to provide useful data for the various applications. Then this is how the spacecraft itself will look like. And of course, the challenges involved is the realization of a field of view of 1.05, the inner solar radius, and 2.5 arc second pixel spatial resolution. Then the scatter issues, then the high voltage required for both the ASPEX payload and the PAPA payload. Contamination issues related to imaging payloads of SU-80. Of course, the contamination issues, we can definitely say we have a significant handle, because the ASTROSAT also carries a UV telescope, which has had many technical challenges of maintaining the cleanliness required, and a good handle is available on this right now. Then the stringent pointing accuracy requirement, and then the magnetic test facility required for calibration and evaluation, and there's a large boom required for deployment. Apart from this, after the Mars mission, there is a significant amount of interest in seeing not only our own missions, but there is a large number of collaborative interest from various space agencies. We have now currently a team which is going through a study phase of looking at whether we should do another Mars mission, or we should go for a Venus mission or an asteroid mission. And also with the capabilities that is going to come up both with GSLV Mark II and subsequently Mark III, what kind of missions should be planned for future. So this is still under discussion. And once these study teams gives us the output, we will decide on what programs to be undertaken. Then I would also like to bring to your kind notice that, like I said earlier, Chandrayaan-1 data is available in PDF format in the ISSDC website. There are a large number of users who have registered for taking this, and the total data download requests have been more than about nearly 2,000. And we have also made announcement of opportunity for utilizing the MOM data. You can visit this website for getting more details on this. Then apart from this, I'll just quickly run through some of the ground instruments that are being used at various places. This is just a compilation. Of course, ISRO is working for some of them along with the other agencies. Now, scientific teams working on astrosats are expected to expand to universities during the proposed phase of observation phase. And we are having large amount of discussion with IUCAA on how to enable this, how to make more and more academic institutions and student community to take interest and work on this. Then physical research laboratory, for example, recently established a multi-application solar telescope, a half meter diameter system, which has been commissioned only on the 4th of this month. This commissioning took place, and it is going to provide significant amount of solar observation capability from ground. Then you also have the advanced radial velocity all sky search instrument, and also an infrared telescope at Mount Abu. Then of course IAA, many of you will be familiar, has a number of instruments which are operating at Kavalur, then at the Kodaikanal Solar Observatory, then Himalayan Chandra Telescope, and also TMT, where the Indian effort to join the international consortium is being led by IAA, ARIS, and IUCAA. This is progressing. Then the National Center for Radio Astrophysics, and this is also very close here, NCRA. Then you have the Giant Meter Radio Telescope System, then the Ooty Radio Telescope System. And of course, the Aryabhata is also establishing a large telescope, ARIS, which works in the up to 1.3 meter apertures, and also it has got a capability to go to thermal infrared. then Raman Research Institute and also TIFR Balloon Facility. Then among the space science promotion activities, ISRO is engaged in ensuring planetary science and exploration program is supported, where the idea is to nucleate research groups in universities and national laboratories and provide state-of-art laboratory research facilities as part of this program, organizing workshops in various important topics. Then we also have a space science promotion scheme where we support and strengthen the research in space science area in universities. And few of the universities have been selected in the country under this scheme. You also have, we support International Astronomy Olympiad, and ISRO partially funds the Indian Astronomy Olympiad program annually to encourage students with good foundations in physics and mathematics and interest in astronomy to pursue further studies in this field. Of course, on the 26th of January, this is just a picture of what Mount Abu observed, one of the asteroids. Okay, this is another just observation from the Mount Abu half-meter telescope. Okay, so that in a nutshell, I thought is what the work ISRO is doing and also some of the ground systems that are being used here. So thank you very much for the patient hearing, and if you have any specific questions, I'd be more than happy to.
Good evening, sir. My question is, in Western countries, there are some new rising capitalization of the space industry. So do we see in future India also participating, privatization and companies coming in this field? And
yeah, already things are changing, and you can see that in India also, see, we have a couple of companies which have come up in Bangalore, which have tied up. For example, one of the companies has a tie-up with a German company, and now they have started making CubeSats or small satellite things. And there are also a large number of companies in the country who have been providing subsystems to us with our technology. Now, they have reached a level where they are now interacting with the international companies, and very soon a large number of tie-ups are going to happen, and we are also encouraging that, because such companies are in a position to provide not only to ISRO's requirement, but they will also be able to provide to international requirements. And this scenario is changing very rapidly also because the opportunity available is tremendous. You might have heard that OneWeb, they are planning to put something like 600 satellites in a period of 4 years. So no single place it will be possible for them to do all the realization. So they are also looking out for places where systems could be realized. And there is a tremendous opportunity in the country, and we are seeing many youngsters taking up this activity and then developing. ISRO in general is supporting such activities to the extent we have about 3 or 4 companies where they have reached almost a stage where they're tying up the contracts.
Good evening, sir. So my question is, as of now, on par all throughout the international space and jet engines, organizations are trying. So does ISRO plan to have a single space entity where it can use a single stage vehicle for re-entry purposes as well for the future use? Once that can incorporate the jet engines as well as the rocket engines into one, and use it for
them. Yeah, see, currently what we are doing is we have reached a stage where we can put about 2 tons into geostationary orbits, and currently we are working for 4 tons using cryo engines. But at the same time, we are also working on reusable launch vehicle technology demonstrator. This is only the first step. We still have a long way to go, but R&D activities on this reusable launch vehicles, whether two-stage to orbit, single stage to orbit, these are under the discussion phase. Our first demonstrator experiment, which is going to carry in a wing body, which is 1/6 of the actual size, that sometime in the last quarter of this year, we will have a launch of that. But we still are a long way away from what you are talking about. We are currently concentrating on ensuring that we will be able to put our immediate requirements of up to 4 tons into geostationary orbit.
I'm an electronics engineering student, so I saw in your slides there were a lot of instruments which you were having as payloads. So at this stage during our engineering, what skills should we possess or try to acquire so that ISRO or agencies like ISRO can recruit us?
Okay, for ISRO to recruit, one of the problems that we have is typically on every year, the intake is in the range of 150 to 200 people. Out of that, we have an Indian Institute of Space Technology, which almost takes away about 100 people. So that leaves us roughly about 100 per year as the new intake. And in this, the disciplines that are covered are from electronics to chemical engineering, all disciplines are covered in this. So to that extent, the new intake into the organization itself is not a very significant number in that sense. But notwithstanding that, what you can see is in the country, the support that we are taking from the industry and the industry itself is taking in a large significant amount of students or new intake that is happening. So there it will be possible. Now what skills you need to get into any of these things is primarily to be able to actually look at problems, find ways of solving the problem in an innovative manner, making use of the various enabling technologies that are there, how you can adapt them and find solutions to the problems that exist. So if you are able to solve problems, I think you will get in, whether it's ISRO or anywhere else, you will find a good opportunity.
So I am Anish Khare, studying in 8th standard. Our Prime Minister mentions the SAR satellite. The SAR satellite is going to be used by the SAR countries. What is going to be its ultimate objective?
Okay, now the SARC satellite itself, what we are currently planning, and last month there was also a meeting of all these SARC country delegation had come. And see, primarily the objective here is to provide to each of the countries some transponder capacity. So typically about one transponder, about 36 megahertz bandwidth, that can be used in those countries for providing broadcasting or disaster connectivity, telecommunication, VSAT terminals connectivity. Primarily what we are trying to propagate is that each country will be able to make use of that transponder for whatever applications they want, whether it is education, disaster monitoring, and we are also trying to link up all these countries for providing information about meteorological conditions, weather, and then interlinking for libraries or the various, and also we are trying to link up all these countries, whether it's external affairs people or political people, so they'll be able to communicate with each other. So if you establish good communication, that communication can be used for various applications. So we intend to provide to each of the country roughly one transponder, and there'll be still some transponders which will be available for linking all of these countries together and provide information on disaster, telemedicine, teleeducation, health, so many other applications. That is what is the current plan.
Good evening, sir. One of the unique selling propositions of India in recent times has been the cost effectiveness of our space missions. So I wanted to ask, why isn't ISRO really looking at it very seriously to make some kind of a citizen science or citizen technology participation, the way we have in software development as open source? So like this student here just mentioned about electronic skills. So okay, there will be many who cannot get in because of the reasons you mentioned, but you can still participate in your own hobbyist way, in an amateur way, or whichever way you please. So why not ISRO pay serious attention to that?
Yeah, see, today, for example, if you look at, you would have heard that many of the universities are building small satellites, micro, mini, or nano satellite type of thing. So that is one area where many of the universities and student community is working on that. And what we also intend to do in the subsequent times is we are trying to look at, provide opportunities in our future satellite. We are going to reserve some space if for anybody who can come up with a bright idea of a new application, so there will be a certain amount of space power available on the satellite, so that payload can be hosted by us. So we are very soon going to come out with announcement on this. So whether it could be a private company or it could be a university or it could be any institution, if they have a bright idea of a payload which they can put to specific application, we will provide opportunities for them so they don't have to worry about building satellites and all the rest of the things. Only that particular payload they can worry about and then make that. So this is one of the ideas that we have, which we are going to make an announcement very shortly.
Just to continue my question, those two ways are great, autonomous ways, the university autonomous project as well as the autonomous standalone space on a satellite. They're great. But what I was trying to ask, I don't expect an immediate answer, but what I'm trying to propose is that in a very real sense, a particular group of, say, 15 scientists who are employees of ISRO, who are working on a live project and have a certain small assignable task which can be just given to a group of professors who have a group of students, hobbyists, and they do it and it is validated, tested, and it's fine, then it's accepted. So that will really add to the cost effectiveness USP that India as a spacefaring nation has.
Yeah, I think I see your point, what you are telling, but we need to come up with some workable mechanisms where we can invite proposals from various institutions. And see, today in some way what is happening in various centers of ISRO is the ISRO centers on their website are putting areas of interest for them. So on those areas of interest, if anybody is interested in working, we have a program called Respond. Under that, we do certain activities. But still, so far, our own experience has been these Respond activities, where in each of these Respond, we could be spending as much as over a period of 3 years, up to 25 to 30 lakhs we fund for that, where the persons can work on a specific problem of interest. There will be another person identified in the organization. Between them, they work on certain areas. But today, one of the problems probably is in the academic institution, the kind of facility that is available for them to carry out research in the new areas. See, so far, if you take India as a country, we are trying to do only catch-up activity. What others have done, we are trying to catch up. But it cannot go on forever. We need to look at areas where others have not worked. We need to work in the newer pioneering ways of doing things and then do things for the first time. Such a thing is possible only when people on the various academic institutions start applying their mind and coming up with new ways of doing things without depending on the current technologically enabling hardware. So if we depend on that, it will continue. See, for example, today if you take, let's say just for chips case, if you take, today we are talking of 180 nanometer being available, but already people are doing 9 nanometer, 14 nanometer. But if we continue to do the catch-up, we will never go ahead. So this is where the real challenge exists, and it is for us to make sure that we can come up with newer ways of doing things which others have not done. I will be more than happy to receive specific proposals from any of the institutions. And taking forward your point, we will definitely look at ways of promoting such opportunities. One of the things we were considering is provide a substantial amount, a period of 4 to 5 years, where a substantial amount of funding is provided. And then using that fund, the activity is completed. And if it succeeds, it gets into the system. If it doesn't succeed, okay, we close down that. And so we need to change the way we are doing our Respond program. So that also is one of the points. We will be more than happy to take new inputs on that.
My query to you pertains to the propulsion system. How far is ISRO away from developing a fully functional semi-cryogenic engine? And also, is ISRO pursuing development of other propulsion systems like ionic propulsion and also nuclear propulsion? If yes, what is the current stage of its development?
As far as the semi-cryo is concerned, The engine development is in a very advanced stage. We will be able to do the engine. We are going to demonstrate the in terms of the engine itself within a matter of 1 year. But we also need to build test facilities for testing that. That is taking some time. So we are looking at alternate ways of doing the test using facilities which are existing elsewhere. That is on the semi-cryo. And the ion propulsion, in GSAT-4 itself, we attempted to put an ion propulsion system on a small scale model. But we are currently working on a couple of satellites, GSAT-19, etc., where ion propulsion is going to be used. And ion propulsion is one of the important areas where we need to work on, because we can substantially reduce the weight of the satellite for the same functional capability, almost to the tune of about 1.5 to 2 tons weight we can gain if we use electric propulsion. So we are working on that. And nuclear propulsion, of course, we are not working on at this point of time.
Sir, excuse me for radiation. As you rightly say, the cost of the instrument, cost of the instrument itself, and the terminal, right, external of the technology, one electron microscope costs 9 crores. We just have one in that. You just tell you whether ISRO is working on sun rays as a vehicle for the energetic electricity. I asked Saraswat, Anil Kapoor, I want to put it on.
No, you are talking about solar powered satellite thing? Okay. So at this point of time, only certain studies had been done, and our current assessment is the technology required for transporting the generated power from space to ground is the real issue. And unless that, there some new methods are found, currently it is not viable is what is the basic argument that is existing. But there are other things that are being looked at. Instead of trying to transport it to ground, for using it in space itself, it could be useful. Yeah, for such things, the work could be done, but we ourselves are not doing much at this point of time apart from some specific studies which is going on.
So as you mentioned towards the end of your slide that your next focus was Moon yet again and Mars and Venus. What is stopping us from rather than the inner solar system planets to moving to outer solar system planets, including probably moons of Jupiter and Saturn? Is it planetary position or is it our vehicle, our capabilities of the probe?
Yeah, one of the thing is of course how much velocity we can impart with the current launch vehicle systems and the propulsion system that we have. That is one of the reasons. So it will be unless we come up with still heavy lift vehicles and other propulsion systems like electric propulsion systems, etc., going further and further. Still is a question.
Environment has become a big part of awareness. Even our Prime Minister is now mentioning about the awareness of environment. What do you think is a part of ISRO in case of environment, awareness about it, or whatever steps that have been taken, ISRO has taken part into it about the conditions, changing the environmental conditions and how it can be improved.
Now, if you are talking about the climate change, climate impact type of thing, then we have a series of Earth observation satellites which can provide some data on this. And then using that studies on what is going to be the impact of climate change on whether it's agriculture or whether it is various activities which are carried out. On that also, we have set of people who are working on such activities. So we have an Earth observation program which encompasses observing Earth in various spectral bands and various wavelength regions, and also weather-related studies. We have got we are going to come up with a very high-resolution geostationary satellite which can provide nearly continuous observation of the Earth in various spectral bands, covering hyperspectral imaging, etc., which could provide significant inputs on atmospheric parameters, atmospheric chemistry parameters. So we have observation capabilities which will be brought in. And other things is using the current data available from the various satellites, both our own as well as internationally available. There are teams working on the impact of climate change studies, etc.
Sir, can you put some light on the human spaceflight program that ISRO is pursuing, and what is the status of the launch vehicles? And also, in terms of training, in terms of simulation on ground, has there been any progress in terms of developing a new breed of astronauts?
Yeah, one of the key things is the human space program has to be first approved by the government for carrying on. So currently what we are doing is, notwithstanding that, whenever they say you should work on that, you need certain critical technologies. So we have been working on developing certain critical technologies for human space program. One of the thing is, for example, space suit that is already realized. Then we had a crew module which was launched, sent up to about 100 kilometers and it came back to Earth. So the ability to survive the atmospheric re-entry, so those technologies. And we are also going to do some experiments where pad abort test, that means in case you have some human beings and at that launch time you have a contingency. So what we are doing at this point of time is working on a set of critical technologies which can be developed. And once the government gives the necessary approvals for conducting a human space program itself, then we will get full swing into that.
Just following up with that, are you planning to collaborate with other nations which have human spaceflight capability?
Yeah, definitely. Today, one of the things is there is no point in reinventing the wheel unless it is absolutely essential. So as and when such programs are approved, collaboration will be part of that. And we will be making, it could be like in terms of training the people, we could make use of the facilities available elsewhere. So definitely collaboration will be part of the process.
Okay, my question is related to Mars orbital mission. So you said that we lost the control on Mars orbiter for 1 month. So after 1 month, how did you get the control on that Mars orbiter?
Okay, see, what happens is during this period of solar conjunction, while the satellite is doing all its job properly, only because we do not have communication with that, we do not know what is happening. So at the end of that period, the satellite is doing its job fine, so it is pointing towards the Earth and it's beaming the signal. So as soon as the conjunction period was over, we are able to get the signal, so we didn't have to do anything. So what this shows is the satellite was doing all its job properly without any mishap. And what actually happens is, like, suppose you look at sun directly. So you are so much, your eyes are saturated and you cannot see the nearby objects at that point of time. Same way the antennas, when it is looking at sun, signals get saturated, and though the satellite is sending its signal, it gets buried in this noise coming from the sun. When the sun moves away from that antenna direction, then the signal what is coming from the satellite is picked up. So actually what it shows is this autonomy that was built on the satellite was doing its job properly. So it did not encounter any event, and it was doing all its functions satisfactorily. And it was, like I said, we have only a 2-degree field of view. Even if the pointing error happens to more than 2 degrees, then you don't get the signal from the satellite to the ground. So that way, it was one of the critical events for us, because it was for the first time that we were encountering such a large time gap with communication. So now that we have gone through that phase, our confidence on the performance of this for a long time is guaranteed. We have more than about 40 kg of fuel still available on the satellite. So we expect it to live for a pretty long time. Thank you.